Okay, now we come to CNS tumors part C. That is, now we are going to discuss intraspinal tumors. So our intraspinal tumors are commonly divided into three groups: extradural, intradural extramedullary, and intramedullary tumors. So extradural tumors, they are going to lie outside dura mater. This blue thing that you can see is the dura mater. Intradural extramedullary is, it is inside the dura mater but outside the spinal cord parenchyma, and intramedullary tumors, they are going to be inside the spinal cord, the proper spinal cord. So the extradural tumors, they are originate in the vertebral body and less commonly in the epidural space. They can come from the vertebral body and they can even come from the epidural space. So epidural, because it has to be outside the dura because they are extradural, so it is going to be in the epidural space, but it is less commonly in the epidural space. And most of them tend to be malignant and represent metastatic tumors. So it's mostly mets that are coming to the vertebral body and they're going to even affect your spinal cord. And they come particularly come from the primaries, from the lungs, breast and prostate. Now spinal epidural metastasis occurs in up to 10% cases of the cancer patient. So spinal mets, 10% cases. Other common extradural tumors, they're going to include lymphomas and multiple myelomas. So just remember, 10% is not written. 10% of the cancer patients that would be having spinal epidural mets. Moving on to the symptoms of extradural tumors. The first symptom that the patient will come with is pain. So the pain in the vertebral area, usually in the thoracic lumbar area. So pain here will have a characteristic feature that it will be exacerbated by recumbency, especially at night, by movements and by coughing or sneezing. So whatever can increase the intrathoracic pressure and abdominal pressure, so that the patient will have aggravated symptoms of pain. Pathological fractures are also quite common with extradural tumors of the spine. And as the tumor will enlarge and compress the spinal cord, we will find myelopathic signs in the patient. That may be evident in the form of paraparesis or paraplegia, hyperreflexia and spasticity. Also on examination, we will find a sensory level deficit appropriate to the spinal level. Coming to the diagnostic workup in extradural spinal tumors, the first investigation, as we always know, is CT scan. Now CT scan here will help us visualize the extent of bony destruction the tumor has done. Next investigation and the gold standard always is MRI. Here we are going to do MRI with gadolinium contrast. It is to visualize the extent of neural element and soft tissue invasion. Next comes your CT guided needle biopsy. It is also recommended to establish the diagnosis in case of an occult primary cancer. So especially in an occult primary cancer, which is not evident, occult means hidden, you can go for CT guided needle biopsy. Now since most of the tumors in extradural spinal tumors are metastatic, so you need to go for metastatic workup and find out the primary source of the cancer. So in this, you will do chest x-ray and CT of the chest, abdomen and pelvis. Chest x-ray because most of the primaries are lung cancer. CT, chest, abdomen, pelvis, and the other primaries, chest, lung cancer, pelvis, usually prostate cancer. Next you have to do a bone scan, prostate specific antigen, because serum PSA level determination is important, because one of the primaries, most common primaries, is prostate. Next comes mammography in women, because breast cancer is also a common primary source of ED spinal tumors. Now the treatment of extradural spinal tumors. So the mainstay of treatment is surgery plus minus EBRT. So EBRT is primarily your radiotherapy. So we're going to study both the parameters, when you have to do or not to do. So EBRT needs to be given when the tumor is radiosensitive. So EBRT is given depending on the radiosensitivity of the tumor. Now, when do you need to do surgery? So, there are only four indications of surgery. They are progressive neurological deficit, pain refractory to medications, progressive kyphotic deformity, and if the tumor is radioresistant, that is the primary met is radioresistant, like melanoma, RCC, etc. So, four, the neurological deficit is increasing, medical treatment is not working, there is a kyphotic deformity, or the tumor is radioresistant. Now, the surgical approach is directed towards the tumor area whether, so primarily you have to dissect the vertebral body and then you have to go to the tumor and remove it. So the surgical approach involves, we can do a simple laminectomy through posteriorly, has to be done posteriorly, laminectomy simple, or you can go for vertebrectomy. You can just cut and remove the vertebra. So vertebrectomy, you can have two approaches, posterolateral thoracotomy, or you can have a thoracoabdominal approach. Now, if there is a radical spinal oncology surgery, because you have seen laminectomy or vertebrectomy, so you have removed a part of the vertebral body, so it is going to require stabilization. So stabilization in the form of instrumentation is always, always recommended in radical spinal oncological surgery. Now, talking about interdural extramedullary tumors, these tumors are located within the dura. The orange thing that you can see is the dura mater. These are located within the dura but outside the substance of the spinal cord. So this is your spinal cord. They are going to be located outside the substance of the spinal cord. Now, most of these intradural extramedullary tumors, they are benign in nature and arise from the, they can either arise from the meninges and give rise to meningioma, or they can arise from the nerve roots and cause schwannomas and neurofibromas. Also, IDEN tumors, they can be metastatic tumors. Now, how will this metastasis arise? Because, you know, this would be your, because this would also have a subarachnoid space between the dura mater and the spinal cord parenchyma, you're going to have the subarachnoid space. So the metastatic tumors, they may also seed this area through subarachnoid seeding or subarachnoid spreading. So what tumors will cause subarachnoid spreading? These would be the tumors that are lying either in your ventricles or they are in the lining in the ventricles. So ependymoma and medulloblastoma, they are found in the ventricles or near the ventricles, hence they cause, and also lymphomas, they can cause metastasis, IDEM mets through subarachnoid spreading. Now, talking about other spreading tumors, there can be lymphomatous spread into the subarachnoid space. It may lead to meningeal carcinomatosis, that is leptomeningeal disease. And how are they diagnosed? They will be diagnosed through CSF cytology, through a lumbar puncture and MRI studies. So there can be direct subarachnoid spreading, or there can be lymphomatous spread into the subarachnoid space. Subarachnoid spreading and lymphomatous spread. So the spinal meningiomas, they are more common in females as compared to males, and they mainly involve the thoracic region. Almost 82% of the intradural extramedullary tumors, they occur in the thoracic region. Now, based on the location in the spinal cord, they tend to occur more laterally. Almost 68% of the tumors are lateral, and posteriorly are 18%, and anteriorly are only 15% to the spinal cord. Now, schwannomas. Now, what tumors can arise here? Because the schwannomas and the neurofibromas, these are mostly your intradural extramedullary tumors. Schwannoma, neurofibroma. And they tend to arise where there is a nerve root, because your Schwann cells will be present over there and your nerve is taking origin from there. Now, plus these schwannomas, focusing on schwannomas, they tend to occur more on the sensory portion of the nerve root. So sensory nerve roots, they are posteriorly, and your motor nerve roots are anteriorly. So this is a rule, thereby sparing the motor portion anterior Anteriorly, motor portions are not affected. Schwannomas are mostly going to affect dorsally or posteriorly. That is going to, they are going to affect your sensory roots mostly. Now, these tumors, IDEM tumors, they may extend through the nerve root foramen into the extraspinal space. This is going to be your extraspinal space. And they'll give the shape of a dumbbell appearance on MRI. So this is very characteristic of IDEM tumors, that they are dumbbell shaped on MRI. So this is something that you really need to remember. These lesions are best evaluated by contrast enhanced MRI, that is gadolinium contrast MRI. And for the treatment, they are frequently amenable to surgical resection with minimal morbidity. Now coming to intramedullary tumors. These tumors originate from the substance of the spinal cord, and patients are usually going to experience myelopathy and sensory disturbances below the level of involvement. The two most common tumors that are intramedullary tumors are astrocytomas and ependymomas. The preferred investigation of choice is MRI with gadolinium. As usual, I've told you, MRI, that is contrast enhanced MRI, has to be remembered. It is always the investigation of choice, mostly for all the serous tumors. The treatment of intramedullary tumors is laminectomy followed by maximal tumor resection without causing significant neurological deficit under functional monitoring. Now, the other less common intramedullary tumors include dermoid and epidermoid neoplasms, lipomas, and hemangioblastomas. Now let us study spinal ependymomas and astrocytomas individually. So ependymomas are the most common glioma of the lower spinal cord. So it will be present in the lower cord. It will affect conus, medullaris, and phylum terminale. So 50% of your ependymomas, spinal ependymomas, will be seen in the lower cord. The next most common location will be the cervical cord. They are generally very slow growing tumors, benign in nature, and they are typically encapsulated and they have a cleavage plane between the tumor and the normal cord, which makes gross total resection feasible. Now you need to remember, it is gross total resection is feasible. Coming to astrocytomas are, conversely, they tend to be more infiltrative and less amenable to a total resection without significant neurological deficit. So if you try to remove it totally, you will end up in neurological deficit. So what the surgeons, they prefer to do, they tend to remove it partially till you will not damage your spinal cord. So total resection is not usually possible in a case of astrocytomas. So as you would be seeing that microscopically, ependymoma may be still there. Astrocytomas, total resection is not possible. So in this case, if total resection is not possible, what can we do? We can do EBRT, radiotherapy for residual ependymomas and most of the astrocytomas. So with this, we come to the end of CNS tumors.